Welcome. In this session, we are going to understand device forensics for Android mobile devices. As far as Android file format system is concerned, you can see that Android devices has eMMC card or memory technology devices installed. These are available on board and these are connected to the circuit directly. The devices are partitioned into following format, in which the very first section we have a master boot record, which we call as MBR, which is of 512 byte size. It starts from sector 0 to 0. Then we have bootloader stage 1 and bootloader stage 2. This is known as FW bootloader 1 stage 1 and this is bootloader stage 2. These range from sector 1 to sector 62. It is of around 15 KB to 16 KB size. Then we have U-boot, which is the universal bootloader for Android mobile devices. It starts from sector 63 to 718. Then we have a trust zone software, which makes sure that if a hacking occurs or a buffer overflow exploit has been performed on Android devices, it should not infect bootloader and master boot record system. So we cannot execute anything or we cannot modify any byte by crossing trust zone software. Then we have a U-boot environment which is of 16 KB size from sector 123.1.2.1.2.6.2. Then we have the kernel, which is around 8 MB for Android mobile devices. Then we have some reserved space and then the starts ext4 file format system for Android system, which is of around 1 GB size and it is stored in memory card block 0 partition number 2. Memory card block 0 is something called eMMC card, which is available or installed on board of an Android mobile device, and this eMMC card is directly connected to the circuit. It is a permanent card which is installed and we cannot remove this card manually. Now then we have a 2 GB user data size and this is stored in partition number 3. Then we have Android cache of around 256 MB and then we have FAT32 storage for devices, for Android device, wherein you can store your images, music file and a lot more. So that is stored in memory card block 0 partition number 1. So as far as forensics is concerned, user must be interested in the user data section if he wants to hijack or if he want to analyze data of a mobile user, which is available in partition number 3 on eMMC card block 0. So now what next we have to do? Now we are going to proceed to practical demonstrations, and we are, for the demonstration, we are using an Android device, which is Android Andy 4.3J. We are going to analyze this device. This device is a rooted device on which we have root access available. We can gain root access using super user privileges. Once we have got super user privileges, now what next we want? We want to make use of a command prompt, that is cmd.exe. On this command prompt, I will gain access to the Android shell. And once we have access to Android shell, we will be executing all the commands on Linux device using this command prompt. Now what next we want? I would like to gain reverse shell access of this mobile phone on my computer here. In order to do that, I would like to start listening for shell on port number 6789, in which LVP stands for listen, verbose and port number. We will be listening on port number 6789, and from the Linux device, I would like to transfer shell of my Linux phone, that is my Android phone, to my Windows computer, and this concept is known as concept of reverse shell. In this, we are going to execute netcat. We are going to connect to 192.168.0.102. 102 is the IP address of Windows machine, and on this Windows machine we have a port number 6789 listening. Once we are connected to port number 6789 on IP address 192.168.0.102, which is Windows device, we are going to execute a command, and this command will be /system/bin/shell. So we are going to transfer /system/bin/sh. So once we execute this command, you can see that a connection will be made from this mobile phone to my Windows machine, and once we have got the connection, we will be able to execute Linux commands from our Windows computer, and these commands will be directly executed on the mobile phone. So now, from my Windows machine, I would like to execute ls command, and you can see that I have a list of file system available. Now what next we want to do, we want to perform memory forensics or storage forensics on Android devices. In order to do that, the very first thing which we want to check is the file format system and the partitions which are available on this Android device and where these partitions are mounted. So that is our sole interest. As far as devices are concerned, we have an eMMC card which is known as MMC Block 0, and it is divided into multiple partitions, in which partition 1 is storage, partition 2 is Android system, partition 3 is user data, and partition 4 is user cache, is Android cache. So now what we want to do is we want to see all the partitions available, and this we can quickly check through a quick command known as dumpcat info. So this dumpcat info is available within /dev. We can also, it is available within the process directory. Within the process directory, we have dumpcat underscore info, and as soon as we execute this command, so you can see that we have executed this command cat. Using cat, we can read this file, process dumpcat info, in which on the left hand side, we have the partition name which you should open. Second property is size of the partition. Third is start address of the partition for a eMMC card or MTD devices. On the current device which we are using has eMMC card installed. In new devices, we have MTD devices available. So if type of partition is 1, then we can understand that it's an MTD, memory technology device partition. If type is 2, then it specifies that it is an embedded multimedia card. And finally, we will have actual name of the partition. So now what we have is, here you can see that, let's say we have a preloader available. This preloader has the actual name /dev/miscellaneous/mta6575sd0, that's the SD card 0. Then we have the master boot record, we have bootloader stage 1, then we have uboot, that is the next bootloader. So all these things are available. This is the partition 1 on which we have Android file system available. Then on partition number 2, we have the cache available. On partition number 3, we have user data available. On partition number 4, we have storage, that is our FAT partition. On partition number 5, we have secure read only, and these are the following partitions which are available. And on 6, we have the Android file format system. So this is how memory device eMMC card is partitioned into multiple partitions, and for every partition we have a specific type of data stored in it. So now what we want to do is, once we have identified the partition list, what next we can do is we can go to the device block section, wherein we can see the list of memory device partitions available. So we can execute list /dev/block, and within this you can see that we have some loop devices and we have this MMC block device available which has partitions 1 to 6. So eMMC card is of our interest, and in case if we want to get dump and if we want to get access to data available on a mobile phone, we can read data from MMC block 0 partition number 3. So in order to read this, we can also make sure that data partition is, that data directory has this partition mounted. So we can execute a simple command known as mount command, and once we execute mount, you can see that here within this partition P3 is mounted on the data directory with ext4 type of partition, and we have read write access on this data directory. Now in case if you want to list data directory, you can see that on this data directory we have a lot of things available, like we have apps available, we have profiles available. Then we have a complete list of data set available within data. You can execute print working directory command. You can again go into data. You can print working directory, and you can see that we are into data at the moment. If we execute ls, now you can see that we have all the application packages available. And within every individual application package, we have the databases available. So let's say in case if we want to check the database for an application known as WhatsApp. So we can quickly search for the package of WhatsApp application. Then we can go into the WhatsApp directory. If we print the working directory, we are into WhatsApp. If we execute ls, now you can see that we have preferences, we have databases, all these things are available. In case if you want to check the shared prefs, you can see that we have a preference file available. We have register phone, verify SMS, multiple preferences are available here. In case if you want to go for databases, so we can go into databases and we can see that these are the list of databases available, in which messagestore.db is the file which has access to WhatsApp messages. Now in the same way, we can, if we check the current working directory, we'll just come out of WhatsApp. And here if you want to check something for, let's say if we want to see in which database we have contacts available, so we can see that our contacts are available in com Android providers contacts, and we can quickly get the contacts from this package. So in order to go into the package, we can simply execute com.android.providers.contacts, and we are into the directory databases. Then what we can do is, let's say we can quickly go into the databases and we can do a list. So now you can see that within databases directory, we have a contacts 2.db, which we can quickly transfer from mobile phone to a Windows machine. And in order to transfer that, I would like to quickly give you access to that. So I will open a new command prompt. This command prompt will be a receiver of files. So what I would like to do, I would like to proceed to the directory cd digital forensics workshop. And within this directory, what I would like to do at this moment, I would like to make a demonstration here in the directory. Let's say I would like to make a demo directory, and within this demo directory, I would like to receive the files. So in order to receive the files, what I would like to do, I would like to open a new port 6788, and whatever data I will receive, I'm going to store that into contacts2.db. So this is how I will be receiving data. So now I'm listening on port number 6788, and I will be receiving contacts2.db file. Now if I go to the phone, from here I can use netcat, I can wait for 3 seconds, I can specify IP address of the server on which I want to transfer the file. So I know the IP address of my Windows machine, that is 102, and on this we have a port number 6788 listening, and I will be transferring contacts2.db from here. So once we execute that, we'll receive a connection here, and once we receive a connection, we'll get the files downloaded. Now if we execute dir command, you can see that contacts db of around 748544 bytes have been transferred, and now using SQLite 3 program, we can open the databases. So in order to do that, what we can quickly do is, we can open this, we have received contacts2.db. Now quickly we can use SQLite 3 program and we can open contacts2.db. So once we have opened that, we can make a list of help commands which are available. Now using this, we are going to get tables available within this contacts. So you can see that we have many tables available, and we can proceed to view contacts in order to view the contacts from this mobile phone. Now what next we want to do is, let's say we want to set the header on and mode into column, or we can directly execute select star from SQL commands into select star from view underscore contacts. And once we execute, you can see that no collation, if no collation occurs, you can execute the command again. And now you can see that we'll have a list of phone numbers available, which is stored in our mobile device. So this is how you can see that we have around 4,791 contact number stored. So this is how you can get a list of contact information stored. And now what we can do is, so if we execute tables here, so in order you want to get the numbers, so you can get proper numbers from view raw contacts. So what we can do is, we can simply execute select star from view underscore raw underscore contacts. So now if we execute that, so now you can see that numbers will be executed, and on ID 4791 my contact number has been stored. So let's say I would like to view the number. So as soon as we'll retrieve all the contacts stored from this device, so now you can see that here we have a list of all the contacts stored within the phone. So here we have, at the bottom we have the WhatsApp contacts, and at the top we have individual other contacts available. So now you can see that here we have a number stored for this particular user, and if we proceed further we have individual information available. So various other options are stored. So what you can do is you can again go to dot tables and you can get a list of individual phones and contact number. So this is how we can read details from mobile phone. So once we have got access to this, so this is the data which is stored inside mobile devices within the data directory. So now we are into this current directory, so we'll just come out of the directory and we'll see print working directory. So now we want, let's say we want to capture all the things which is available inside data. So it is very difficult to copy one by one, and we don't have copy access to this. So what we can do is, instead of copying data from data directory, we can take the dump of our partition number 3. So in order to do that, I would again like to show you mount command, and I would like to show you that within this data directory, my partition number P3 of my eMMC card is mounted. So now what I would like to do, I would like to take a device dump of this partition number 3, and I want to store that into SD card, because SD card has some size available, and then from SD card I would like to copy that directly to my computer for analysis. To do that, now what next we want to do, we are going to make use of DD command, which is used to copy and convert files. We can copy data from one device to other device using DD command. So here we like to take input file. Input file will be the file which we will be copying from, and this file is /dev/mmc/0 partition number 3. That's MMC block. So this is the device from which we are going to copy. And then we are going to define an output file in which we are going to store data. So on my machine I have an SD card, then I have a SD card 2, and within this SD card 2 I would like to store my data. So at the moment I would like to get my data.dd. I would like to create a file known as data.dd, and let's call it as, I'm going to call it as Android user data, or generally it's known as user data. So we can simply proceed to userdata.dd, and now the block size will be of 4096 bytes. So now what we can do is we can quickly start copying the file. Once the files will be copied on the device, we are going to get a message that some bytes which were available inside MMC block 0P3 have been copied to userdata.dd, and we will quickly resume as soon as the file is being copied. So now once we resume, you can see that these many bytes have been transferred in 185.866 seconds from our main memory block partition number 3 to userdata.dd file. So now what we can do is, let's say we want to specifically test ls-l, and we want to test sd card /sd card 2, and we are going to list this device, and within this device what we want to do is we want to grep user data. So as soon as we search, you can see that we have a userdata.dd file in which we have around 53687091 bytes have been copied. So now once we have got data from the partition number 3, which belongs to user data for Android, now what we want to transfer this userdata.dd to a computer in order to perform analysis. So at the moment you can see that we are connected on to a phone, and we are executing all the commands on the mobile phone, and without any physical USB connection we are transferring files over the network. So how we will be transferring files from a mobile phone to a computer, let's have a look. So in order to do that, first of all we'll proceed to the directory in which we are taking the results. So we are taking data inside Digital Forensics Workshop GNIoT, and we are going to receive data within the demo directory. So within this demo directory, at the moment you can see that it's empty, so we are going to keep that here. And next what we want is, Then what we want is, we want to have another command prompt using which we are going to receive the files. So this is going to be the listener using which we are going to receive the files. So let's say this would be the listener. This would be our transferring machine from which we are going to transfer data, user data. This shell belongs to our computer. So now what we'll do, we'll proceed to digital forensics CD demo directory. And now within this demo directory, you can see that, let's say we are going to keep that here. So now what next we want to do, first of all, we are going to use Netcat in order to listen verbally on port number 6788, and we are going to receive user data.dd. So we'll be receiving, so we are listening at the moment on our computer. Now we'll go to the shell of our mobile phone. As soon as we print the current working directory, we are into data directory. So now we'll switch to /sd card /sd card/sd card2. Now if you print the working directory, you can see that we have changed the directory to SD card 2. Now from this SD card 2 directory, we are going to use Netcat. We are going to wait for 3 seconds. We are going to connect to 192.168.0.102, which is our Windows machine, on port number 6788, and we are going to transfer user data.dd file. So once we execute that, once the file has been transferred, we are going to get a message on the mobile phone that file has been transferred, and all the data will be stored within this user data.dd file. So at the moment you can see that it is of 0 bytes. Now once we execute the transfer, so we have started transferring the file. As soon as we have pressed enter, now we are going to receive the data. Once we have received data in the command prompt, that file transfer has begun. If we refresh, you can see that on user data, at the moment 0 byte has been transferred. At the moment around 6.6 MB has been transferred. So the transfer process has started. So now once the complete file will be transferred, we will be able to analyze this user data.dd file using a hex editor. And we are going to make use of WinHex editor, which is one of the best hexadecimal editor and forensic tool in order to grab data from hex images. So we will quickly resume as soon as our data gets transferred from our mobile phone to our computer machine for analysis. So now once we resume, here you can see that user data has been successfully transferred from mobile phone to computer device. And if we refresh the size, you can see that eMMC card has data around 512 MB, and that 512 MB has been copied from mobile phone to computer. So now, once we have got this user data copied to computer from our mobile phone, now we need to analyze this device. So in order to analyze this, we are going to make use of a hex editor, which is known as WinHex. WinHex is one of the most powerful hex editors. You can go and purchase a licensed version for WinHex. In demonstration version, you will be only able to retrieve files which are less than 200 KB of size. Files greater than 200 KB will be identified but will not be retrieved in demonstration version. At the moment, I'm using free trial demonstration version of WinHex. You can simply download WinHex from X-Ray's website, and to do that, you can simply proceed to Chrome and you can proceed to google.com, and from Google you can simply search for WinHex plus download. The latest version for WinHex is 19.2, and you can quickly download that from xways.net WinHex website, and you can click download here and your application will get downloaded. You can simply use next install and WinHex will be installed in your machine. Now post installation of WinHex, you can search for WinHex on your machine. You can run WinHex as an administrator. Once application runs as an administrator, now what we like to do, we like to perform analysis. In order to perform analysis, we are going to create a new case, and let's say at the moment we like to open a file, and let's say the file which we are going to use is user data.dd file. So now what we want to do, we want to open this file. And here you get a message in the evaluation version that you cannot save files that are larger than 200 KB. So all the files which have been retrieved or which has been identified will be visible to you, but you won't be able to evaluate or you won't be able to retrieve files larger than 200 KB in this evaluation version. So let's click on OK, and now you can see that userdata.dd has an offset starting from all zeros, and as soon as we proceed down you can see that we have data available on this device. So here you can see that we have a lot of data, commands, push notifications, a lot of information related to Android available. So as soon as we proceed down, once you proceed down, you can see that you will have n number of files, images and information available on Android. So now what next we want to do is, on from this complete memory device we want to retrieve information. In order to retrieve information from this device, what we can simply do is we can go to tools section. Within disk tools we can go to file recovery by type, we can click on OK, and now you can see that on the left hand side we have a specific file types of interest. You can select all the files which you want to receive, and then what we want to do is we'll go to the directory demo, and within this demo directory we are going to create a new directory known as case 1. Let's call it as case 1. So we like to retrieve all the information within case 1, or let's just create that case 1 directory within demo 1. So within case 1 all the information will be stored, and now individual subfolders will be created once 2500 files count has been over. So once we click on OK, now analysis has been started, and now you can see that analysis is being running with a speed of 5 GB per second, and now you can see that we have got 11,916 file headers which were found, in which 1510 files were retrieved. Other files were not retrieved due to 200 KB size limit, and 78 files are supposedly incomplete or corrupt. So let's click on OK. So now once we click on OK here, here we have got all the information. So we'll proceed to the directory where we have created the case 1, and in the case 1 directory you can see that we have got a lot of information. First of all I would like to open the log file which is going to display me what types of headers have been used in order to search. So these were the headers which have been used in order to identify files from the Android file system. And then with the evaluation version you can see that we cannot save files larger than 7 or 200 KB. So here some JPG files have been identified. Here you have a library SO file which is greater than 200 KB, so it's not saved. Then you can see that you have got some SQLite databases available, XML files, JPG files have been identified. There is another library file. So library files are not saved due to being more than 200 KB size. So here you have got a list of files which have been saved and which have not been saved. So now what we are going to do, we are going to view all the files which have been retrieved. So here you can see that we have a list of files retrieved. So at the moment I would like to view the preview as well. So now you can see that we have got a list of files available, and now what we want to do is, let's say we want to put them into medium icons so that we can see what type of data has been retrieved from here. So at the moment you can see that we have multiple icons available. We have some XML files which are stored in the phone. So we have icons somewhat like this, WhatsApp, camera, these Android icons have been stored. Now you can see that we have got some people photographs identified. This is the file which has not been completely fetched from WhatsApp. Here these images of people. So now you can see that we have got many information images from the machines. So some files which have not been completely identified are being displayed like this, and this is how you can see that we have got individual people. So these photos I believe are available from WhatsApp. So from WhatsApp you can see that individual photographs have been identified of the users. So it's like an important thing that if somebody has got access to your dump, he can quickly view images of from your secure files as well. So this is how important informations are retrieved from Android devices. You can see that we have some PDF icons and a lot more things available. We have individual zip files which we can extract, and we can see what all contents are available. We have some SQLite databases available which we can open using SQLite 3, which I have already shown you previously in this session. So here is the set of information which has been retrieved from WhatsApp or from mobile devices, and all these contents are of user data. In case if you want to take dump of any other file format, system or partition, you can specify the input file from that device block, and you can specify the memory card block 0 partition number, and you can get the dump into your SD card. You can download SD card data into your machine, and then you can proceed to analysis using Windows Hex Editor. So I hope you understand how mobile forensics is performed and how data is retrieved from Android devices. Thank you for watching this session.